Today, I will discuss a very rare autoimmune disease that affects cartilage all over the body, and it is called relapsing polychondritis. Very often, I see patients struggling to get this diagnosis because the signs and symptoms can be quite diverse, and not many physicians are used to diagnose relapsing polychondritis. Let's learn today about the 13 most common signs that should prompt a medical evaluation for this disease. Are you ready? Let's begin.
Rheumatologistoncall.com.
Relapsing polychondritis affects 1 in 300,000 people. It is an autoimmune disease where your immune systems starts attacking the cartilage in many parts of your body, from your ears to the nose to the eyes and the skin. This is a systemic disease, and many patients can show non-specific signs like low-grade fevers, fatigue, loss of appetite, and a general feeling of not being well. However, there are more specific signs that should prompt evaluation. The inflammation of the cartilage will cause pain, swelling, and if it's not treated, will eventually lead to cartilage destruction. So it is crucial to recognize these early signs of relapsing polychondritis and get the treatment promptly. Number 1. Red swollen ears. Red swollen and painful ears can be one of the earliest signs of relapsing polychondritis. Not all patients develop it initially, but most patients will develop this sign over time. The outer rim and the antihelix become red, hot, and painful, especially when touched. It often starts on one side, but it can evolve to be on both sides. Because they resemble an infection, these acute flare-ups are commonly misdiagnosed at first. With repeated bouts of inflammation, the structural cartilage in the ear degrades and causes a floppy, deformed appearance in the long-term run. I had a patient who, before she developed ear pain and swelling, she had many episodes of skin rashes that were treated as hives. Interestingly, these hives did not respond to anti-allergy medication, but they always responded to steroids. A few years after these episodes of hives, my patient started to develop ear swelling and pain, and she was eventually diagnosed with relapsing polychondritis. Number 2. Bridge of the nose changes. The nasal bridge cartilage also frequently falls prey to inflammation during these flare-ups. In addition to pain, redness, and swelling, the bridge of the nose often looks widened, flattened, and it twisted over time. Since the cartilage provides structural support, this damage will eventually cause the middle of the nose to collapse inside. The classic saddle nose deformity develops in about 25% of patients with relapsing polychondritis. Some patients can also develop nasal stuffiness or crusting or even bleeding that we call epistaxis during the relapsing polychondritis flare-ups. Number 3. Inspiratory stridor. The trachea is another part of the body that contains a lot of cartilage. In relapsing polychondritis, inflammation can affect the tracheal rings, leading to airway changes, wheezing, and whistling breathing sounds that we know as stridor. It can happen initially during flare-ups, but in time, it can become a constant problem. Some patients get even misdiagnosed with asthma. If you develop sudden shortness of breath or stridor, this is an emergency sign, and you should be evaluated immediately in the emergency room and receive treatment, as you might be in danger. Number 4. Hoarse, weak voice. The larynx and the vocal cords also contain a lot of cartilage, and they can be affected during these inflammatory episodes. Patients with relapsing polychondritis often notice that their voice is affecting. It can grow husky, strained, gravelly during these acute flare-ups. In severe cases, nearly total loss of voice can happen from inflammation and scarring of the vocal cords. Number 5. Costocondritis. While inflammation can affect all types of cartilage, relapsing polychondritis tends to involve costal or rib cartilage. I actually have a patient who developed pain in the right side of her body that was investigated heavily and nothing showed up. She also had a surgery and they removed her gallbladder, but again, that was not enough. That was not helpful. Eventually, the pain went away on its own. I also had a patient with severe chest pain, and again, after extensive workup, the doctors were not able to identify what was the cause of the pain. And it was actually costochondritis. Episodes of tenderness or pain along the rib junctions are frequent. These bouts of costochondritis may shift to new rib locations over time. Number 6. Joint swelling and pain. Relapsing polychondritis can cause inflammation of the joint's cartilage, causing pain and swelling. And while arthritis can strike any joints, the knees, wrists, ankles, and elbows tend to be most susceptible. Arthritis can migrate from joint to joint, but it's usually not causing erosive changes like rheumatoid arthritis. Number 7. Eye inflammation. Relapsing polychondritis can affect the eyes. The inflammation can affect all eye structures. Symptoms can range from mild discomfort and redness to extremely painful inflammation, which will require urgent eye evaluation. Vision changes are also possible, and even vision loss can happen. One of my patients started to have an acute onset of double vision, and she ended up having surgery to correct that. But the surgery was not helpful. Eventually, she developed other signs of relapsing polychondritis. Number 8. Vertigo and balance issues. Inside the inner ear, we have the apparatus responsible for our balance, called the vestibular apparatus. During relapsing polychondritis flare-ups, some of the components of this apparatus get inflamed, which will result in balance issues and issues with spatial orientation. Some patients developed spinning vertigo, lightheadedness, and unsteadiness. These episodes can come and go. Number 9. Heart involvement. Although rare in about 10% of relapsing polychondritis patients, the heart can be affected, and especially the valves of the heart, because they contain a large amount of cartilage. The valves are the gates between the heart chambers. When the heart valves get affected, patients can develop signs of heart disease and new heart murmurs, because these valves become incompetent and they cannot close fully, so a part of the blood can regurgitate during the time that the heart is pumping. More rarely, the muscle of the heart can be affected, causing myocarditis. Number 10. Skin disease. Skin lesions are also seen in patients with relapsing polychondritis, but many times they are not specific to this disease. From rashes that look like purpura, to livido reticularis, to what it looks like sweat syndrome, or hives, all can be seen in patients with relapsing polychondritis. Some people develop one or multiple skin abscesses that are actually very hard to treat despite taking multiple rounds of antibiotics, but they do respond to steroids. They can also look like skin vasculitis, but again, the skin rashes remain rather non-specific for this disease. Number 11, nervous system involvement. Some patients can develop cranial nerves inflammation that can affect the 2nd, 6th, 7th, and 8th cranial nerves. This will lead to symptoms like visual changes for the 2nd cranial nerve, eye movement issues for the 6th cranial nerve, bell palsy for the 7th cranial nerve, and vertigo, tinnitus, hearing loss when the 8th cranial nerve is involved. There are other neurological signs reported in patients with relapsing polychondritis, but they are rare, like hemiplegia, seizures, or aseptic meningitis. Number 12, gastrointestinal tract involvement. Some patients with relapsing polychondritis can develop difficulties or pain with swallowing food, and that can result from inflammation of the epiglotta, leading to epiglottitis. If relapsing polychondritis is associated with vasculitis, then the GI tract can also be affected. And there are some cases of patients with relapsing polychondritis that also develop ulcerative colitis or Crohn's disease. Number 13, kidney inflammation. Kidney involvement is rather rare, but it can develop in patients with relapsing polychondritis that have an associated vasculitis. Small amounts of blood or protein can be seen in the urine, along with a rise in the creatinine level. These are signs of kidney function deterioration, and it is important to get tested for other forms of vasculitis that may also affect the kidneys, like ANCA vasculitis. As you can see, relapsing polychondritis can affect multiple organs. The more cartilage the organ contains, the higher the chance of being affected. The ears, nose, trachea, and joints tend to be the most vulnerable. Relapsing polychondritis most often happens in episodes, followed by periods without any symptoms. So that is why many times patients get diagnosed late. Hopefully, this video gave you a lot of information about this disease. If you were diagnosed with relapsing polychondritis, please share your journey and leave me a comment in the bottom of this video. If you find this video helpful, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to my channel to support my educational mission. If you need my help, my company, Rheumatologist OnCall, helps people all over the United States when they need it the most. Thank you for watching, and I will see you soon.
Rheumatologistoncall.com